Nuptial flights are now happening in some parts of the globe. For those people who are unaware about nuptial flights, this is the mating behavior of some insects, including ants, during warmer nights. When the conditions are favorable, such as the temperature and the humidity of the environment, the winged male and female ants from ant colonies will emerge and begin their nuptial flight. For some species, they also consider the day and time when mating. But have you encountered a queen producing an alate at her founding stage? Well, actually, I observed this scenario to my tetramorin bicornatum before. The colony with less than 10 workers had already produced a princess. How crazy, right? But currently, I have these two queens of Solenopsis geminata, which I caught on the same night, but with different strategies of raising their colony. So let's meet them in this experimental video. The tropical fire ants are highly aggressive and invasive, so you might encounter them in your yard, especially in tropical countries. So as I mentioned earlier, I caught two fire ant queens in our yard. We will call this queen without wings as queen number 1, while the second one is queen number 2, for us to identify the progress of the colony's founding. As you can see, queen number 1 had already shed her wings and taken care of her brood. This is normal situation for ants in their founding stage. So let's proceed to queen number 2. She kept her wings like some queen ants usually do, and has successfully produced a lot of brood. But you would notice each larva that was isolated from the group. Weird, right? Considering that the colony is too young to produce each worker, having this giant larva is totally insane at the founding stage of ants. Anyway, I'm only assuming that this huge larva is a major worker. I am super excited to see the promising and adorable ant from this larva soon. After a few weeks, this is now the queen number 1. She already has workers. Look at those cute ants. It is so relaxing to observe how the queen ant successfully raises her nanitic workers. Let's check our queen number 2. She's still waiting for her first batch of workers. Look, keepers, notice the two giant larvae. However, I noticed the first giant larva is isolated from the rest of the eggs. I realized that it was already damaged. I don't know what happened to this larva, since the colony is secured in the test tube setup. After a couple of minutes, I was shocked when I saw the queen eating the larva. Therefore, I am confident that she is the reason why this larva got damaged. I know that this species is fully claustral, so she doesn't need any food during the founding stages. Thus, there is something wrong with this queen. So I assume that this giant larvae will not turn into pupae anymore, but will convert it as food for the colony. As the time went on, queen number 1 had successfully produced 7 workers. My first friends in the ant-keeping habit, who are David, Darren, Kim and Vincent, told me that the colony needed to feed some honey at this point to nourish their weak queen who didn't eat during the founding stage. So I give them a honey straight to the test tube setup. And of course, the cute workers immediately devoured the sweet food that they will later share with the rest of the colony through trophallaxis. On the other hand, this is queen number 2, or should I say, our colony number 2. She has 6 workers. The giant larvae last week are now super giant larvae. The workers are feeding the larvae as seen on the video. So I thought that this larvae would turn into pupae in several days. After some days, the colony number 1 is now stable with the addition of new workers. Soon, they will have their own major workers, which will be responsible for protecting their colony from predators. Let us check the queen number 2. The first larva is now able to eat by itself now. I'm so glad to see this activity. But my happiness suddenly ended when I saw workers eating the other giant larva. Therefore, I came to the conclusion that the future giant larvae will not turn into pupae anymore. But why are they doing this? Based on research, invasive ants, like tropical ferns with low genetic diversity, sometimes produce sterile diploid males which do not contribute to the colony labor or the reproductive output. The queen will cannibalize her diploid male larva or feed it to other larvae. In the world of cluster ant species, the queen will keep herself in a chamber and raise her first brood using her fat reserves. And when the workers emerge, they will forage outside the nest and feed their queen and their brood through trophallaxis or the mouth-to-mouth feeding. With these activities, rapid growth of the colony is important for their survival. That's why producing diploid males will be highly unfavorable for them. The goal of the malalite is to only mate with the queen. They do not forage and eventually die after mating. Producing a male member during the founding is not the priority of the queen, because 1, it will not feed her, and 2, it requires more fat reserves than worker larvae to develop. Hence, the queen will not waste her energy on feeding a useless male over workers. Through this technique, the queen will gain nutrients and will subsequently give them to productive members of her brood. So if you ever encounter a Solenopsis geminata, which is similar to queen number 2, she will have a slower growth of workers, since half of the brood will turn to sterile diploid males and the other half are the sterile female members of the colony. After several days, this is the colony number 1. While the colony number 2 continues to produce a diploid male and eats it after this. I am a little bit off because I assumed that this colony would be the strongest fire ant colony I ever had, but none of these larvae develop into pupae. While the colony number 1 is continuing to grow with a lot of workers who are ready to face their first live prey soon. Thank you for watching, keepers. Join me again next time as I observe these fire ants. See you on the next one.